Hello everyone, welcome to the session 7. These three are the objectives in session 7. We will learn about holography, then injection pumping, which is actually a special type of pumping method used in semiconductor lasers. In the case of holography, you know that it is a way of recording image in such a way that we will get a three-dimensional impression of the scene. So in order to do that, there are two steps in holography. The first one is recording and the second one is reconstruction. So in the recording process, what we do is we have got an object here which is shown as a cube here. This is the object whose hologram is to be recorded, and for that we use a coherent light beam. As an example laser, we use that coherent light beam, and that will be split into two using this beam splitter. So one portion of the light source is going to the object and it falls on the object, and the object will reflect the light which has fallen on it, and that reflected light will be collected on a photographic plate. Now in addition to that, from the beam splitter, one portion is going in a different direction. That is actually the reflected portion. The transmitted portion went ahead and it fell on the object, and the object reflected and we collected it on the photographic plate. Whereas the reflected light from the beam splitter, it falls on a mirror, and we use a sufficient number of mirrors so that we can ultimately guide the light to the photographic plate. So on the photographic plate, two beams are falling. First one is the light which was reflected from the object. We call it the object beam. And the second one is undistorted light from the source. Only thing is that we are deflecting the light using beam splitter and mirror, and that is also falling simultaneously on the recording medium. Here it is written as photographic plate, but it is better to say it is a holographic plate. And that light which is falling directly on the holographic plate is referred to as the reference beam. So two light beams are falling on the plate, recording medium, simultaneously, and that will create an interference pattern because these two beams are derived from the same source, object beam and reference beam. They will create an interference pattern. So so that process is referred to as the recording. And after recording, what we are going to see on the recording medium or the film which we kept here is an interference pattern. An example is shown here. So by looking at this interference pattern, we will have no idea what the object is. So that step is the recording process. Now in order to find out what was the image which that was captured on the photographic plate, we'll have to do one more step which we call the reconstruction. In the reconstruction process, what we have to do is we'll have to illuminate the hologram using the same reference beam which we used for the construction process, which means if you used a laser for recording the hologram, you will have to illuminate the hologram using the same laser. And then during that process, this step is what we call the reconstruction stage. And during the reconstruction stage, we will be able to see the image of the object which is recreated. So that's why it is called reconstruction. So even if the object is not there, we will get the impression that the object is there because of the reconstructed object wave during the reconstruction process. So if you view it from here, you will be able to see the virtual image here. So that image is actually the virtual image that we see. And interestingly, if you illuminate in such a way that the angle of incidence or the angle between the reconstruction beam and the photographic plate is the same, then you'll be able to see the image exactly at the same point where we kept it during the construction process. But this is not a mandatory condition. Depending on the angle between the reconstruction beam and the holographic plate, you'll be able to see image from different angles, or the different aspects of the image can be seen. Even in this case, if you are tilting the holographic plate, you will be able to view the image from a different direction. So that is actually the three-dimensional aspect of the image created in the holographic process. Now, there are various ways in which you can keep the object and illuminate it and record the impression on a holographic plate. If you search in the internet, you will be able to see different configurations in which you can set up the experiment for recording and reconstruction of the hologram. Now I would like to talk to you about this also. If you search in the internet, you will be able to see many surprising descriptions about hologram. For example, a whole person, image of a whole person has been created, and it is people used to call it as hologram, and a live telecast of the hologram of a speaking person or a dancing person or a singing person will be telecast to distant locations. But in those cases, it is not exactly the hologram in the strict meaning of the hologram that we have just discussed. All these are actually three-dimensional projection. You have a picture, and that will be projected as a three-dimensional projection to a screen, and that creates the impression that it is a hologram. But you'll have to keep in mind that these are not exactly the hologram in the strict sense of the hologram. Now, just to see, I would like to quickly explain how we are able to recreate the virtual image of an object during the reconstruction process. So this is a simple theory which will be nice if you understand. For example, when we say that during the reconstruction process we are recreating the object, why is it so? Is because during the reconstruction process we are recreating the object wave. If you have got the object wave, or if you can somehow make the object wave even in the absence of object wave, then that object wave is the wave which is coming from the object, right? So if you can recreate the object wave somehow, then that will give us a feeling that the object is there. So how we are doing it in holography is explained in a simple manner here. This is for example, during the recording process, what we do is, on the holographic plate, object wave and reference wave is falling. So when two light beams are falling on a same surface, the intensity will be the sum of the two. So that is the idea that we are using here. And the intensity of light, which is the electromagnetic wave, is the square of the amplitude of the electric field component. So that is how we are writing it. For example, object wave can be written like this, because it is a sign, it can be represented by a sinusoidal wave. So we will write it as O equal to the amplitude component OO. This is written as the xy component because it is falling on a plane which we refer to as the xy plane. So the amplitude component is written as OOXY, and the phase factor is written as e raised to I psi xy. Similarly, the reference wave can be written as ROXY e raised to I phi xy. The difference between these two are obviously there is an intensity difference which is represented by the amplitude factor OO and RO, and obviously the phase factor will also be different, because by the time these two waves are hitting the holographic plate, they will be traveling different distances, so the phase acquired will be different. So the phase factors are written differently, one is psi and the other one is phi. Now when they both are falling on the medium, the intensity will be the resultant of the two, and for that what we do is, first of all we will add the electric field and then we will take the square of that, and we'll assume that this is complex number. So we add the intensity electric field component first, and that is O plus R, and then we take the modulus square of that, since it is complex number. In order to take the modulus square, we will multiply it with the complex conjugate. So that's why I have written it as O plus R multiplied by O plus R conjugate. Okay, so you just have to, A plus B into C plus D, like that. You just take, each of the terms in the bracket should be multiplied with the other term, and you can write it as OO star plus RR star plus OR star plus RO star. And then you have got the equation for O and R, and we will use it. And for example, OO star will be the modulus square of the amplitude factor of the object wave. So I have written it as IO. Since it is modulus square, it will be intensity. O is actually the electric field component, and O star will be the intensity. Similarly, R star is the intensity of the reference wave field component, and OR star and RO star are the cross terms appearing here. So that will contain a difference between the respective phase factors. Okay. Now, so that is actually the intensity distribution that we have recorded on the holographic plate. When I say that there is interference pattern after recording, that interference pattern is actually redistribution of intensity of these two lights which are falling on the plate, and that is represented by this equation I. Okay. Now the next step that we do is we will illuminate the hologram during the reconstruction process using the same a laser light or the light source that we use for constructing the hologram. So since the hologram contains an interference pattern, it is actually, you know, black and white lines or some patterns there. So it is actually a transparency. The opaque region will block the light and the transparent regions will transmit the light, and the extent to which it can transmit will depend on the transparency. So that is why I have used this transmission term tau xy. So that is written as the transmission efficiency or the transmittance of that holographic plate. So when you use that kind of, you call it that interference pattern, you have got a glass plate or something like that, and on which you have got some dark and white bands which is the interference pattern. So we call it the transparency. And when you are illuminating it using the reference beam, ultimately what is coming out is the product of this transmission and the reference field. That is why it is written as H, which is actually the output the resultant component after you illuminate the interference pattern or the hologram using the reference beam. What we are going to get is tau multiplied by R, where R is the reference beam. Now tau is a function of this transmission, so therefore it is written as, you know, you can use it you can write it in terms of the intensity pattern which is recorded on the recording medium. So you can write it in this way. This is one option. So you can let me write it as like AT0 plus BI0 plus BIR into reference beam, because tau is actually the function of the transmittance of that hologram. So when you do that, what we are going to do is all what you have to do is, in the previous slide I showed you the intensity pattern, and that intensity pattern, it is sufficient to multiply that with the reference wave. Here why we have used a different function is because the transmittance will be a function of the intensity distribution on the hologram. So if you when we say it is a function of the intensity distribution, it can also be, you know, a constant into the intensity pattern which is recorded. So it will be sufficient for the time being, just to understand how this object wave is reconstructed. It will be sufficient for you to multiply at this stage R with the previous intensity pattern I showed you. Okay. So when you do that, you will be getting different terms, because in the previous example there is OO star term, RR star term, like that. There were four different terms, and each of those terms should be multiplied with the reference wave. So when you do that, we'll be getting different terms, and you will analyze each of these different terms. And the object wave is that wave which will contain the same phase factor as that of O, which we represented earlier for object wave. And you know, there will be a term which does not make any change in phase factor. So that will be the component of light which is directly transmitted by the transparency. And then there will be the complex conjugate of the object wave. So these object wave and the complex conjugate of the object wave are the two images that we can reconstruct during the reconstruction stage. An object wave will create the virtual image, and the complex conjugate of the object wave will make the real image. So that is the theory of hologram. You can just write it in your own equations and find out how you know, all what you have to do is find out the intensity distribution during the recording stage, and you multiply it with the reference wave, and you analyze each of the terms and see which one is the object wave, which means the term which is having exactly the same phase factor will be the object wave, and the complex conjugate of that will be the complex conjugate of the object wave. So that is how, you know, it is surprising that even in the absence of an object wave, we will feel the impression that the object is really there. It's not like looking at a photograph, you know, you will see this virtual image. If you remember, what's the difference between this virtual image and real image? You know, real image, you can let it fall on a screen. For example, you know, any image that you can see on a screen is a real image. Whereas virtual image will not fall on a screen. So when you reconstruct the image in the case of holography, that virtual image that you see, it doesn't need a screen, you know, to be able to be seen. It will be, you know, you will get the feeling that it is floating in air. So if you just move around, you'll be able to see different sides. You'll be able to look at that image from different sides. So that is that three-dimensional idea, you know. Even if that object is not there, you'll feel that it is there. So an example is shown here. This glass plate, it is actually illuminated using green laser. So that is, that contains the hologram, you know, and you can see this fly, image of this fly. So it is actually the reconstructed virtual image. Even if the fly is not there, you will see that it is in the air. So that is what we call, you know, if you tilt this hologram, you will be able to see this fly from different sides. So, you know, even if that object is not there, we will feel that it is there, and that is the idea of holography. You will see the three-dimensional, you will get the three-dimensional impression. So this kind of holographic technique is used to record, you can, for example, if that fly is moving, you can capture its hologram at different instance, different point of time. And for example, how this is used in research is, you can use the, you can record the hologram on the same holographic plate of this creature which is moving. So if you want to analyze the way in which its wings are moving, for example, then you can capture the hologram of that fly at different instants of time, and that can be done on the same recording medium. So when you reconstruct the image, you can for example, you know, reconstruct the different instance of its motion, and we'll be able to analyze, even if that creature is not there, you'll be able to analyze it from nearby. So that is the idea. So if you can record many hologram on a single holographic plate, that is actually another advantage of this holography compared to conventional photography. On the same medium, you will be able to record many images. And if you reconstruct it, you'll get the feeling that the video of that object is being recorded. So that is the way in which that is one way in which it can be used for research. Now another aspect of holography, here you can see this, you know, you have got a hologram which is holographic recording medium is actually some kind of polymer which is coated on a glass plate. So you can either use a glass plate, or you can use another transparent plastic sheet on, and this recording medium will be coated on that sheet. And here it is a glass plate, and you can see it has been broken after recording. So the image of this dies, it's being recorded on this holographic plate, but it is broken. And this this picture that you can see now is actually the reconstructed image, and you can see from both these pieces, you can see the entire image. So why is it so? Is because during the construction process, what we actually do is we are doing this interference. Interference of the object wave and the reference wave is being done, and it is falling on the holographic plate. And every point on the recording medium is capturing a wave coming from every point on the object. So that is the peculiarity of interference, and that is why even if the hologram is broken, we are able to reconstruct the entire image, because every point on the holographic recording medium contains information regarding every point on the object. But the only feature is that if you keep on, you know, breaking this hologram into smaller and smaller pieces, you will still be able to construct the image completely. But the point is that you won't have the provision of tilting it to large extent and view the object from different directions. So some of the aspects, you know, from some direction or from some angle, you will be able to view it completely, but you won't be able to view it, tilt it and view it from a different large number of angles when you are viewing it during the reconstruction process. If it has been broken into very small pieces, you won't be able to tilt it and view it from different directions. But other than that, you are able to completely reconstruct the image. Okay, now moving on to the semiconductor laser, because the second topic is the injection pumping. It is actually a method of pumping used in semiconductor lasers. So here I will quickly explain what the semiconductor laser is. If you have already learned LED and the semiconductor lasers are, you know, they are somewhat similar. Only if you know about LED, what we have is we have got a P region and an N region, and the P region, when you combine them together, you have got the PN junction. And you know, when the electrons and holes are moving, basically these are semiconductor materials, so there is a conduction band which contains free electrons and the valence band which contains free holes. And the conduction band electrons are having high energy, so they will recombine with the holes in the valence band. And during the reconstruction process, it will emit light in the case of LED. So that emission is what we see as the light coming out from the LED. So that, up to that, the whatever is happening in the case of semiconductor laser is also identical. But except, I mean, other than that, one unique feature of semiconductor laser is that there is simultaneous emission of large number of photons, or this amplification of light will be taking place, which doesn't happen in the case of LED. So we will, to understand the working of semiconductor laser, we will just proceed exactly as in the case of LED, and then we will see, in order to have this simultaneous emission, what we should do or what special modification is required in the case of semiconductor laser. So all what we need to do is form a PN junction, and here you can see, you know, you just cannot take any piece of semiconductor material, join them together and form the PN junction and expect that to work as a semiconductor laser, because the way in which we form the junction will decide the quality of light which is coming from that laser. Quality means how, you know, how monochromatic it is, how directional it is. It will depend how much is the intensity, or what is the efficiency with which this can work, will depend on the quality of the PN junction which is formed. So normally what we do is we'll start with the substrate. So in this diagram, it is the bottom darker blue thicker layer which is shown as the N gallium arsenide substrate. Okay, so if I start from the bottom most layer, you can see this yellow layer which is thin. That is actually a metallic contact, because in order to give bias, you need a metallic contact. So on either side, you have got this yellow color layer, that is the metallic contact on which we will connect the battery. Now starting from the bottom, just near the metallic contact, you have got a thicker layer, and that is denoted as N gallium arsenide substrate. Okay, and the way in which that coating will be done is a thin film coating process. We will have this gallium, pure gallium block, a block of or a piece of pure gallium and a piece of pure arsenide, or a compound of gallium arsenide will be taken. And then what we do is we will keep this substrate, or we will keep the plate on which we'll have to make the substrate, that will be kept in a vacuum chamber, and this gallium arsenide block will be kept inside the same vacuum chamber, and we will melt it and evaporate it, and that evaporated particles of gallium and arsenide will be forced, or they will be directed along a gas or inert gas stream, and that will be allowed to fall on the substrate. So on the substrate, this gallium and arsenide molecules, arsenic molecules, will be falling, and that will form a pattern, or they will be arranged as a layer, just like in the case of formation of semiconductor crystals, and that will make this substrate, which is written here as N gallium arsenide. Okay, so that is just the N-type gallium arsenide. So the doping will also be taken into account. Whichever donor molecule that you'll have to use as dopant will also be used along with this gallium arsenide piece. Then above that we will be giving another layer of N gallium arsenide. See, you have got this N gallium arsenide as the substrate, and on top of that you have got the N-type aluminium gallium arsenide. So in order to form the p-n junction, the p region is the N-type and p-type aluminium gallium arsenide. So why do we use gallium arsenide as the substrate is because our material for forming the p-n junction is aluminium gallium arsenide, and this gallium arsenide has got the same atomic arrangement, or the pattern of arrangement is the same, is or same in the case of gallium arsenide and aluminium gallium arsenide. So when we use a substrate in order to form a thin film coating, that substrate should have the same lattice arrangement as that of the film that we want to form, because this lattice arrangement is providing a pattern for arrangement of atoms on top of it. Okay, it is similar to the stacking of blocks. You know, if you have got a lower layer which has got a specific pattern, on top of that you can keep on stacking and the same pattern will be preserved. So that is the function of the substrate. You just cannot use any semiconductor material as a substrate. The substrate should have the same lattice arrangement as that of the film, the P region or N region that we want to form on top of it. So similar to the way in which we form the substrate, the thin film coating method, similar to that we will do this coating of N-type aluminium gallium arsenide also, and top of that we will use coating of P-type aluminium gallium arsenide, so that we have got the P region and N region, which is shown using this lighter blue color, and in between you have got the depletion layer, which is written as the active region, in shown here in pink color. Okay, and on top of that you have got, you know, for robustness of the structure, you have got another layer of thicker gallium arsenide, and on top of that you have got the metallic contact layer. So all these are formed using this vacuum deposition, thin film deposition process. And when we form this kind of a structure, you have got the active region, which is the depletion layer, and it is at the depletion layer this laser action will be taking place. So here it is shown as a red color oval, that is actually the light coming out. So we will see how this light is produced here. This is another way in which you can represent the diagram. You have got all these layers, P region and N region, and you have got the active layer, and you can see the light which is coming out. Why I would like to show this diagram is because depending on the way in which the light is emitted and the way in which you are stacking these various layers, this is divided into vertical cavity edge emitting laser. So in this case you can see these blue photons which are shown here, they are coming from the edge of the active medium, and therefore it is called vertical cavity. Why it is called vertical cavity is because these layers are arranged vertically, and you will be giving the bias on the by applying a potential to the top and bottom layer. So the way in which you are giving the bias voltage is vertical in direction, whereas the light is coming perpendicular to that from the edges. So therefore it is referred to as vertical cavity edge emitting laser. On the other hand, there is another provision. You can design it in such a way that the light will be coming out from the top layer or from the bottom layer. So in that case it will be referred to as vertical. In that case also the cavity will still be vertical, but the light will be coming from either the top layer or the bottom layer, so it is referred to as vertical cavity surface emitting laser. So two types of semiconductor lasers, depending on the configuration of the cavity and the direction in which the light is emitted, is vertical cavity edge emitting laser and vertical cavity surface emitting laser. So here, in order to proceed to the working of this semiconductor laser, what we do is laser will be working, or the population inversion will be created, only after we give forward bias. So if you remember this forward bias and the way in which the potential barrier will be reconfigured during forward bias that you have learned in the smaller classes, you know, initially when we don't give bias, you can see the potential barrier is huge, whereas when you give forward bias, the height of the barrier will decrease. P region connected to positive of the battery and N region is connected to negative, that result in a reduction of the potential barrier. So it is at this stage that the population inversion will be created. And here I have shown another diagram. Here what we have is, on the left you have got the P region, P type semiconductor, on the right side we have got the N type semiconductor, and in between you have got the active region. And we are giving forward bias, which means the N region is connected to negative of the battery. So what is happening is that because of the repulsion of the electrons in the N region from the battery, because it is connected to the negative of the battery, it will be repelled from the side of the battery and it will be moving away from the battery, which means they will be moving towards the junction. And they will cross the junction and they will try to move over to the P region. Similarly, holes in the P region will be moving towards the junction and they will try to cross over to the N region, and that is what is shown here. When, for example, the red color dots which are shown above, they are actually the electrons which are migrating from N region to the, they are actually moving towards the P region, and in the diagram it is drawn at the instant when they reach the depletion layer. So here the way in which we have represented the conduction band and valence band, the position at exact position at which the conduction band will appear in the case of P material and N type material, it will be different. These two are not in the same level, the conduction bands. Okay, the P region conduction band is slightly higher than the conduction band in the N region, because it depends on doping, and it is actually the property of the material. Exactly at which location will be have you can see location means the exact energy value at which you can see the conduction bottom of the conduction band. In the case of N material and P material, it is different because of the doping difference. And similarly, the top of the valence band in the case of P material is higher than the top of the valence band of N material. So when the electrons try to move from N region to P region, if they want to reach the P region, they will have to cross the junction, cross the barrier, climb up the barrier in order to go to the P region. So just before they have they climb up the barrier, they have reached this depletion region, and at this location you can see the number of electron exactly at the depletion region is what I am talking about, where you have seen, you can see these black arrows. So exactly at this depletion region, while the electrons and holes are crossing the junction, we have a situation like this. At this instant, the number of electrons above is much higher than the number of electrons below. Okay, so that is what we refer to as the population inversion. And it is not like the population inversion which we have seen so far, because in the case of ruby laser and other lasers, the population inversion is actually the number of atoms in the upper state is more than the number of atoms in the lower state, whereas here population inversion means the number of electrons, not the atoms. The number of electrons in the upper state is more than the number of electrons in the lower state. Okay, so if you ask me, you know, if you examine this N-type semiconductor material, even in that case the number of electrons in the conduction band is much higher than the number of electrons in the valence band. Here the situation will be different, because these are injected into the depletion layer, and the difference in the number of electrons in the upper level will be much more than the difference you can see in the N-type semiconductor layer. So why these charge carriers are moving to this active region is because of the presence of the battery and the bias which is provided, forward bias which is provided. So in fact, what is happening is all these charge carriers are injected into this active layer. This layer is referred to as the active layer because it is here that the laser action will take place. So the population inversion has been created by injecting charge carriers into the active layer by the battery. So that's why this is referred to as injection pumping. Okay, so now we have got the population inversion, and now next what should happen is that the one electron in the upper state will come down and will combine with the hole in the valence band, and it will emit a photon, and that photon will thereafter trigger all these electrons in the upper state to come down, and similar to the stimulated emission that we have in all the lasers, and that will result in simultaneous emission of large number of photons. Or actually what's happening is that this number of photons will be getting multiplied because of this avalanche nature of this process. So we'll ultimately be having a huge number of photons which will be coming out from the semiconductor laser, whereas this doesn't happen. In order to do that, the first photon which was emitted should somehow come back to the active medium in order to trigger this electron in the upper state. So for that, what we do is, just like in the case of ruby laser I told you, we do polishing at the end of the ruby crystal in order to make it look like a mirror. So similar, that kind of activity is possible if you are using crystal as an active medium. So in this case also, we polish the crystal because we are use semiconductor material as the active medium, which is a crystal. We can polish that crystal in order to give it mirror-like quality. So the photons which are initially emitted will be reflected off that mirror, which is actually the side of this crystal, and it will be going back into the active medium, and it will trigger a stimulated emission and will be getting laser output. So that kind of photons coming back and triggering all these electrons to de-excite, that doesn't happen in the case of LED. So that is the difference in the case of LED and semiconductor laser. So injection pumping is a special type of pumping that is used in the case of semiconductor laser alone. And the working of semiconductor, in order to make it work, you have to give a forward bias, because only the forward bias can inject charge carriers into the active layer. Okay. In the coming session, these are the topics that I plan to discuss. We'll start fiber optics, and we will see the structure of optical fiber and how total internal reflection takes place. And we will begin to develop the theory for total internal reflection, and we'll deal with acceptance angle, numerical aperture, and so on.